Publisher's Note for Good Hunting in Pursuit of Big Game in the West. Good Hunting in Pursuit of Big Game in the West by Theodore Roosevelt. Publisher's Note. This book offers to younger readers a series of pictures of outdoor life and big game hunting in the West. More than this, the author makes us feel not only the zest of sport and adventure, but also the interest attaching to the habits and peculiarities of the remarkable animals which he describes. It is a field book, since it is written by a true sportsman out of his own experiences, and its general spirit tends to a better appreciation of the value of close observation of animal life. The elk, bear, goats, deer, and other animals which are described represent the most remarkable large fauna of our country. These descriptions, by one whose acquaintance with them has been so intimate, have an added value in view of the diminution of their number. It is interesting also to remember that the influence of the author has been constantly exerted in favor of the preservation of big game and the maintenance of national parks and forest reserves, which, in addition to other advantages, include the protection of these noble forms of animal life. This series of articles upon big game hunting was written for Harper's Round Table and published therein in 1897. The picture of ranch life, which forms the closing chapter, appeared in Harper's Round Table in 1896. These articles are now presented together in book form for the first time after consultation with the author. For the title of the book and proofreading, the publishers are responsible. End of publisher's note.
Chapter 1 of Good Hunting in Pursuit of Big Game in the West. Hunting in Pursuit of Big Game in the West by Theodore Roosevelt. The Wapiti, or Round-Horned Elk. No country of the temperate zone can begin to compare with South Asia, and above all tropical and subtropical Africa, in the number and size of those great beasts of the chase, which are known to hunters as big game. But after the Indian and African hunting grounds, the best are still those of North America. Until a few years before 1897, there were large regions, even in the United States, where the teeming myriads of wild game, though of far fewer and less varied species, almost equaled the multitudes found in South Africa, and much surpassed those found anywhere else in point of numbers, though inferior in variety to those of India. This, however, is now a thing of the past. The bison, which was the most characteristic animal of the American fauna, has been practically exterminated. There remained in 1897, however, a fair abundance of other kinds of game. Perhaps, on the whole, the one affording most sport from the standpoint of the hardy and skillful hunter is the bighorn. Though in size and in magnificence of horn, it is surpassed by some of the wild sheep of Asia. There is a spice of danger in the pursuit of the grizzly bear, the largest of all the land bears, especially in Alaska, where it is even larger than its Kamchatkan brother. The moose and the wapiti, ordinarily called the elk, are closely related to the old world representatives of their kind. But the moose is a little larger, and the wapiti very much larger, than any of their European or Asiatic kinfolk. In particular, the elk, or wapiti, is the stateliest of all deer, and the most beautiful of American game beasts. It is a pity we cannot always call the wapiti by its right name, but the hunters and settlers never know him as anything but the elk, and I fear it would be pedantry to try to establish his rightful title. In former days, the elk ranged to tidewater on the Atlantic coast. A few lingered in Pennsylvania until 1869, and throughout the middle of the century, they were abundant on the Great Plains. In 1888, I shot one on the Little Missouri, however. In many parts of the Rocky Mountains and of the Coast Range, the species is still as abundant as ever, and this is especially true of northwestern Wyoming, since that great animal preserve, the Yellowstone Park, swarms with elk and is their natural nursery and breeding ground. The elk is the lordliest of his kind throughout the world. The Scotch stag is a pygmy, but a fourth his size. The stags of Eastern Europe are larger than those of Scotland, and in Asia, larger still, approaching in size a small Wapiti. They are all substantially alike, except in size. The Wapiti is rather easier to kill than the deer, because his size makes it easier to see him, and he is slower in his movements, so that he is easier to hit. When pressed, he can gallop very hard for a few hundred yards, but soon becomes tired. The trot is his natural gait, and this he can keep up for hours at a time, going at a pace which makes it necessary for a horse to gallop smartly to overtake him, and clearing great logs in his stride while he dodges among the thick timber in a really marvelous way when one comes to think of the difficulty he must have in handling his great antlers. Late in September, the rut begins, and then the elk gather in huge bands while the great bulls fight vicious battles for leadership. Hunters call this the whistling time, because throughout its continuance, the bulls are very noisy, continually challenging one another. Their note is really not much like a whistle. It consists of two or three bars, rising and then falling, ending with a succession of grunts. The tone of voice varies greatly in different individuals, but when heard at a little distance in the heart of the great wooded wilderness, the sound is very musical, and to me, and I suppose to most hunters, it is one of the most attractive sounds in all nature. At this season, the big bulls are quite easy to approach by any man at all skilled in still hunting, for their incessant challenging betrays their whereabouts, and they are so angry and excited as to be less watchful than usual. Some of my most pleasurable memories of hunting are connected with stalking some great bull elk in frosty weather when the woods rang with his challenges. One evening in early October, I was camped high among the mountains of western Montana. We were traveling with a pack train and had pitched our small tent among some firs by a brook while the horses grazed in the little park or meadow close by. Elk were plentiful round about. We had seen their trails everywhere, and late in the afternoon we had caught a glimpse of a band of cows as they disappeared among the pines. Towards morning I was awakened by hearing a bull challenge not very far from camp. The sound of the challenge kept coming nearer and nearer, and finally I heard one of the horses snort loudly in response. Evidently the elk saw them, and not making out exactly what they were, was coming down to join them. Sometimes horses will stampede when thus approached, but our ponies were veterans and were very tired, and evidently had no intention of leaving their good pasture. Sitting up in my blankets, I could tell from the sound that they were still in the park, and then the challenge of the bull came pealing up not 300 yards from the tent. This was more than I could stand, and I jumped up and put on my shoes and jacket. The moon was bright, but shooting by moonlight is very deceptive, and I doubt whether I would have hit him, even had I got down to the park in time. However, he had moved on before I got down, and I heard his challenge in the woods beyond. Looking at my watch, I saw that it was nearly dawn. I returned to the tent and laid down as I was under the blankets and shivered and dozed for half an hour. Then I came back to the meadow where the pack ponies stood motionless. In the brightening light.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.